No, no, no se oye.
Se cierra solo. ¿Alguien revise?
Sí, sí, sí. No.
¿Ya
no,
me escuchan?
Oímos, no hay, sin problema.
¿Ya?
Ya.
Perfecto. Quería darle las gracias a todos por la oportunidad de compartir este momento. Yo desde luego no estaré todo el tiempo del seminario, pero nuestro consejero Aristides sí compartirá el evento en la mayor cantidad posible de tiempo con ustedes. Particularmente quiero agradecerle a sus organizadores, a Tony y a Par, porque ellos lo han hecho posible a pesar de que las circunstancias son adversas para todos nosotros. So a warm greeting to all of the participants in this 23rd edition of the Research Forum of Cuba. Nothing can replace human face contact, but virtual contact does not necessarily have to be cold or distant. The key is in the purpose and a passion with which it is organized, and also in the purpose and passion of those who participate. We look forward to the opportunity to be able to do these forums in person in Nottingham and Havana as I designed it. But until then, let's keep in touch and never lose faith. Muchos de ustedes no me conocen. Yo he estado trabajando en el sector de las relaciones exteriores por 44 años. Llegué a Londres el 7 de febrero de este año y todos mis planes para comenzar mi trabajo aquí se vieron interrumpidos por la pandemia. Mis pocos encuentros con algunas personas acá han sido precisamente por esta vía, online o por teléfono. Pero fui muy afortunada porque entre las pocas entrevistas que pude sostener estuvo aquella que tuve con Tony y con Per. Y todas mis referencias que traía sobre el centro, el fórum, su composición, sus promotores, se vieron enriquecidas por aquella conversación. Y porque también pude apreciar que Tony tenía un relevo seguro. Y todo esto, en mi opinión, es muy importante para poder asegurar que este legado que ya ustedes han construido y que continuamente enriquecen, no se pierda. Es también una oportunidad que no quiero desaprovechar de agradecer a la Universidad de Nottingham, porque desde el 2004, si no me equivoco, han acogido este centro de investigación sobre Cuba. Y yo espero que muchos nuevos jóvenes investigadores y académicos, y también los asociados, desde muy, muy diversas esferas, pues puedan apreciar cuánto vale este legado y también los anime a continuar trabajando. Having been able to maintain this important communication channel for more than two decades deserves all of our recognition and also our gratitude. It is especially valuable that in addition to this annual exchange, post-grad workshops are held on Cuba in Europe. Research on our country is encouraged. The relationship between universities and research centers, the creation of chairs for studies on Cuba, and any initiative that contributes to knowledge about my country and, of course, about the Cuban revolutionary process. You have managed to bring together a network of prestigious members endorsed by their professional career, who is a reference for anyone who wants to start or expand their knowledge on this subject. Yo estuve revisando el programa de esta edición 23, que es un programa intenso. Me leí muy cuidadosamente los temas que ustedes van a abordar y sus ponentes, la amplitud y diversidad de estos temas reflejan una visión que personalmente para mí es fundamental, porque no es posible comprender el presente si no se conoce el pasado, si no se conoce de dónde venimos, cómo nacimos como nación y qué nos hizo ser como somos. Y también el papel, el rol que la intelectualidad cubana y la cultura cubana ha jugado a lo largo de toda nuestra historia y por qué y cómo se ha forjado en Cuba una cultura de solidaridad y de resistencia. La interpretación de todos estos acontecimientos y procesos por historiadores e investigadores cubanos es una contribución, en mi opinión, importante, pero es necesario también contrastarla y enriquecerla con la visión de otros. Y esa otra visión la aportan los participantes extranjeros. No importa si hay si se comparten los criterios de una manera total o parcial, o incluso si hay diferencias en los enfoques, porque igualmente es valioso el intercambio en sí mismo. The rapprochement between people of different thought and training is one of the best support of diplomatic work, which is said to be the art of achieving the impossible, and if it happens with mutual respect and transparency. The opening of an event like this, it's common to end wishing their participants every success. But now in my case, it won't be necessary. The guarantee of success is the worth and expertise of you. This embassy and myself are at your disposal here in UK, in Europe, and in Cuba also, in whatever you need in order to support such noble goal. Esta embajada, yo personalmente, estoy a la disposición de todos ustedes en Reino Unido, en Europa, en Cuba también, para cualquier cosa que ustedes consideren conveniente o necesaria y apoyar una experiencia tan enriquecedora como esta del Centro de Estudios sobre Cuba y en particular su foro. Now I let you work. We will see each other again tomorrow morning. Okay? Ahora los dejo trabajar y espero que nos podamos encontrar nuevamente mañana en algún otro momento. Voy a esperar el video que pondrán sobre la participación de Aurora antes de retirarme, pero anticipo un caluroso y afectuoso saludo para todos y me iré después discretamente. Muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias a
Muchas
usted.
Gracias.
Bueno, como dice la embajadora, ahora vamos a poner el video de Aurora Fernández. Un momentico, hay que ver que el sonido funcione, que es también, son palabras de apertura, palabras de inauguración. La tienen.
Buenos días a los colegas.
Gracias, Aurora.
De Cuba. Y buenas tardes a los que en el Reino Unido, a quienes agradezco por su permanente gestión solidaria con Cuba y los buenos recursos humanos y académicos que hemos construido. Es un honor que el amigo Tony Capshaw me haya pedido compartir las palabras introductorias a este foro con la excelentísima embajadora de Cuba en el Reino Unido. Te saludo, fraternalmente.
Muchas gracias.
Continuamos realizando grandes esfuerzos por avanzar en el desarrollo que, según la visión de la nación, el Plan Nacional de Desarrollo Económico y Social hasta 2030, se orienta a un país cada vez más soberano, socialista, democrático, próspero y sostenible. En estos momentos realizamos grandes esfuerzos en la batalla contra la COVID, terrible pandemia producida por el virus SARS-CoV-2. Es obvio que la economía cubana, como la mayoría de los países, enfrenta dificultades muy grandes. Por ejemplo, el cierre inevitable del turismo genera pérdidas millonarias. Es por ello que en julio el Consejo de Ministros aprobó la Estrategia Económica y Social para el impulso de la economía y enfrentamiento a la crisis mundial provocada por la COVID-19, documento que traza el camino que el país está siguiendo para superar el desafío de la COVID-19. En otras palabras, el país trabaja en el enfrentamiento de la COVID y a la vez está adoptando medidas que nos permitan impulsar la economía y continuar nuestro proceso de desarrollo. Son esfuerzos gigantescos que se realizan en medio del reconocimiento del bloqueo a Cuba por parte del gobierno de los Estados Unidos de América, que sistemáticamente genera nuevas medidas contra Cuba, entre ellas el ahorro financiero, mayores dificultades para el envío de remesas, por mencionar solo algunas. Especial interés ha puesto el gobierno de los Estados Unidos por desarrollar una campaña contra los médicos cubanos que controlan el interior. Además de las mentiras que repiten, presionan a los gobiernos para que no acepten la colaboración médica del virus. Los más de 28.000 colaboradores de la salud que Cuba tiene hoy en 59 países ilustran muy bien la profesionalidad y ética de nuestros trabajadores de la salud. Más recientemente, debido a la pandemia, debido a los gobiernos de los países, Brigadas Médicas Cubanas del continente Henry Bid, integradas por 3.031 trabajadores de la salud, han ofrecido su servicio de manera solidaria para mitigar el impacto de la pandemia en 38 naciones, cifras con cierre 18 de agosto. Eso explica el fuerte movimiento mundial por nominar el contingente Henry Bid a los premios Nobel. La solidaridad de Cuba se revela también en el incidente del crucero británico en Estrella, que con casos de COVID-19 no encontró acogida en varios países de la zona y fue recibido por Cuba. A pesar de todas las dificultades, Cuba sigue de pie y no se decide. Quiero aprovechar para comentarles algunas experiencias relacionadas con el enfrentamiento a la pandemia. El enfrentamiento a la COVID nos ha dejado muchos aprendizajes y ha demostrado la capacidad de Cuba en los ámbitos de la salud, la ciencia, la tecnología y la innovación. Mis palabras voy a aprovechar un par de publicaciones que han aparecido en estos últimos meses en nuestro país y que lo estamos enviando como contribución al Senado. Una de ellas es un artículo de nuestro presidente, Miguel Díaz-Canel Bermúdez, escrito en colaboración con el profesor de la Universidad de La Habana, Jorge Núñez Obrador. Se titula Gestión gubernamental y ciencia cubana y el enfrentamiento de la COVID. El otro es un artículo de varios compañeros de nuestra industria biotecnológica, el primero fue el presidente de COVID, el doctor Eduardo Martínez, y llega por título la industria biofarmacéutica cubana en el combate contra la pandemia de COVID. Con el neoliberalismo, en muchos países la política de salud se ha subordinado cada vez más a la lógica de la ganancia y la competitividad empresarial, y han visto reducidas sus capacidades de respuesta, especialmente en situaciones extremas, que nos lleva a la pregunta, ¿debe ser la salud un derecho universal humano o un bien comercial más, sumado a la regla de la mejora? Como es conocido, el dominio de las transnacionales en la industria médico-farmacéutica mundial poco beneficia a la medicina preventiva, a la atención a las nuevas enfermedades y los perfiles epidemiológicos a los países de uso. Otra consecuencia es que cada vez más es mayor la concentración de las capacidades de ciencia, tecnología e innovación en un grupo de países del norte, porque a la mayoría de los países del mundo en situaciones muy débiles frente a desafíos como esta pandemia. Un ejemplo de esto que hasta hoy el único país en desarrollo que ha logrado presentar un candidato vacunal para prevenir el contagio de la enfermedad ya reconocido por la autoridad regulatoria acreditada es Cuba. Como les comento, seguramente saben, aún estamos en el mundo. El enfrentamiento a la COVID demanda grandes capacidades científicas y tecnológicas y buenos sistemas de salud. Hay varios aspectos que quiero destacar que ustedes podrán profundizar en los artículos que comentaban antes en el libro. Primero, el sistema de salud cubano ha demostrado su capacidad de enfrentar este gran desafío, aún en medio de circunstancias adversas. El país ha desplegado durante décadas una política de salud pública universal y gratuita, absolutamente inclusiva, con un importante sistema de atención primaria. Cuba dedica el 17,5% de su presupuesto para respaldar los gastos de salud y de asistencia social. Cuba es el país del mundo con mayor densidad de médicos por millón de habitantes, con una cifra superior a los 750 médicos por cada 8.000 habitantes. La estrategia seguida por Cuba tiene peculiaridades. Por ejemplo, la pesquisa activa la población, la hospitalización de todos los casos positivos, el aislamiento de todos los contactos, el tratamiento precoz de los infectados asintomáticos, infecciones que no han sido posibles en otros países. Cuba ha logrado mantener las tasas de incidencia y mortalidad en menos de la sexta parte de la tasa mundial, y ahora el índice de reducción por debajo de ojo para evitar la saturación de los servicios de salud. Segundo, lo que se debe destacar es que nuestro sistema de salud no ha actuado solo, antes de que en Cuba se registraron los primeros casos coronavirus, en marzo. A partir de la llegada al país de las primeras señales desde China de una potencial crisis, comenzó el despliegue de una gestión gubernamental integral, intersectorial, orientada a movilizar todas las capacidades científicas, tecnológicas y profesionales desde el país con eso. Valores como la colaboración, la solidaridad, una comunicación social efectiva, la participación de la población, el vínculo directo de los más altos representantes del gobierno y del partido, los científicos y profesionales, han sido determinantes. Las inversiones realizadas en los años 80, nunca interrumpidas a pesar del periodo especial, siempre impulsadas por clientes, permiten a Cuba contar con una industria médico-farmacéutica propia que incluye capacidades importantes en el campo biotecnológico. Ello ha permitido utilizar medicamentos que el país ha creado durante años y desarrollar otros nuevos para enfrentar la pandemia. Se puede decir que Cuba tiene en ese campo una autonomía tecnológica y otros países del sur. En este periodo se ha logrado una muy estrecha relación entre el sector científico profesional y el gobierno cubano, a través de un intercambio activo y permanente entre el sector gubernamental y la ciencia, lo que ha facilitado la toma de decisiones, la movilización de recursos y un trabajo intersectoral y transdisciplinario muy coherente. Esto se ha logrado a nivel nacional, pero también en las provincias y municipios donde se ha destacado la participación de nuestras universidades. Todos estos resultados de aprendizaje posibles para enfrentar la estrategia post-pandemia y continuar en nuestro desarrollo como virus social. Termino agradeciendo nuevamente por la invitación de pedirle estas palabras y recibo un fuerte abrazo solidario de nuevo.
Okay, well, welcome back. We're going to make, before we start the proper proceedings, we will be asking, giving information about etiquette, shall we call it, what we hope people will do and how we'll structure it. So having already welcomed you, I will say nothing more. I will now pass over to Pa, who will give you the details, and then we can start the first session.
Okay, thank you. Muchas gracias, Su Excelencia, la Embajadora, y gracias a la Doctora Aurora Fernández. There'll be a paper, again, with video from Aurora Fernández and Jorge Núñez, the one that she mentioned earlier, later in the proceedings. So just a few things. We're going to be very, very relaxed about this because this is new for many of us, and it's all very strange not to be meeting in person. Isabel Story very kindly has stepped forward as technical expert. She's somebody who doesn't get scared by technology in a way that I do. So if anybody's got any major problems or any nerves, please feel free in the breaks to chat with her, and she can help you out. Okay, I'm sure there's plenty of other people who are used to using Teams as well. So, there she is. Hi, she's welcoming us. On that note, some of these younger ones are much better at multitasking technologically than some of us older ones. And we have a little bit of experience with this from trying to teach before the lockdown started. Oh, sorry, after the lockdown started. Can we try and keep the chat to a minimum during papers? Because it's actually quite hard to listen to someone and focus on them virtually when there's a chat going on. But if there are questions or discussion after each paper, and we will have questions and discussion after each paper, can we do that by making ourselves visible and unmuting ourselves? Okay, so that people can actually see a face to the question rather than having to read a chat, which again can be quite challenging when you've just finished giving your paper. Okay, so the chat, let's use it for any technical issues, and let's use it after the event. So once we've got through a panel and you've still got some questions outstanding, or your question maybe wasn't answered, please put it in the chat and the paper giver can answer that question in their own time. It is a little bit more complicated than that because Microsoft Teams, bless the embargo, is not available in Cuba. And so some of our Cuban speakers will try and be present for their panels, but may not be. But what they can do is send messages or responses to questions on WhatsApp. So I've got WhatsApp on my computer, which is why you see me getting messages from my sister. You'll have to ignore that. So if after the Cuban papers are given, there are questions, again, they can go in the chat or you can type them and I can transfer them to WhatsApp. So it's going to take a while. We'll just have to be patient. Equally, you will know that all of these sessions are going to be recorded in chunks according to panels, and then they will be made accessible globally with the permission of all the participants. Okay, so I'm going to record everything, but I will ask all of your permission before any of these sessions are made public, which means that again, the chat will be permanent. It'll be there forever on the Teams group, or the WhatsApp questions that are asked will be permanent. Okay, so please don't feel that you have to use that time after each paper to ask your questions. If you can, first come, first served. If you can't, there will be other opportunities. We're looking at, because it is quite hard to look at a screen for several hours on end, we're looking at something like 10 minutes per person for their paper, plus another 10 minutes for anything that's not being said, for questions, for discussion, and for me, importantly, to do the changeover to the next presentation. So please try and keep to those 10 minutes. We will be strict. So Tony and I will unmute and tell you you've got 5 minutes left, or 10 minutes left at the end of your 20 minutes. Okay, please bear with us when we do that. Yes, if you can switch your cameras off, well, if you want to go off and do something else, or if you've got another thing to attend to, or if you're tired of seeing your own face on the screen, please feel free to switch off the camera, switch off audio. I hope you all know how to do that. But please, when there are papers being given, those people on a panel, if you could just remain visible, maybe not audible, but visible, so that the paper giver has an audience to look at, because it can be quite disconcerting to speak into a void and not know that there are human beings at the other side. Okay, so let's just try. Let's see how we get on. Is there anything that we've not said? I think that's pretty much it. Okay, so we're going to take 3 minutes. Some people may be in a different room. How would that have happened, Rosie?
What?
Why are they in a different room?
Have they gone on to the COVID thing? Aye, aye, aye.
Izzy, Rosie, can anybody help them out? Asking them.
Thank
That's
you.
Fine. If you can help them out, but let's try and keep the chat as minimal as possible.
Yeah.
It's because it's really not good for us oldies to be multitasking quite this much. So hopefully, let's take 2 minutes just to decompress, switch our videos off, switch our videos back on again, and we're going to start with the right panel, which is panel one, defining Cuba, Comunidad and the Revolution, definiendo Cuba, la Comunidad y la Revolución, and Loredana, John Otto, Steve Wilkinson, and Tony Capture. Okay, so 2 minutes break, and then we'll be right back.
Can you hear me? Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear.
Okay, I'm going to talk in Spanish, that it's easier for me. Of course, if you have some questions also in English, I can answer to them, okay? Muchas gracias a Tony Parr por organizar el simposio online y es un placer estar entre vosotros. Y yo voy a hablar de la Constitución cubana emanada en 1902 bajo la ocupación de Estados Unidos y más específicamente este es un estudio sobre el debate que se desarrolló entre los miembros de la Asamblea Constituyente sobre quién debería ser ciudadano del nuevo Estado por nacer. Tras la caída del colonialismo español y en el contexto de la ocupación de Estados Unidos, la Asamblea Constituyente iba a ser parte de una estrategia orientada a la creación en Cuba de un Estado formalmente independiente, pero subordinado de hecho al control de Estados Unidos, con el intento de crear las condiciones políticas, culturales y sociales para la futura anexión de Cuba a Estados Unidos. También por eso los miembros de la Asamblea Constituyente fueron elegidos con sufragio restringido, con el intento de excluir de la política cubana los sectores sociales más bajos y los ex-esclavos. Sin embargo, los partidos independentistas lograron conquistar la mayoría de los votos y la Asamblea se convierte en el ámbito institucional en el cual podrían confluir y manifestarse los ideales de participación y de igualdad que habían surgido durante las guerras de independencia. En este trabajo, mi intento es analizar la parte del debate que se ocupó de definir los criterios de nacionalidad y de ciudadanía para ver si fue posible convertir los ideales de igualdad en realidades institucionales concretas que pudieran ser una barrera efectiva en contra de los procesos excluyentes que se iban manifestando entonces en la política y en la sociedad cubana. Los constituyentes empiezan los trabajos para definir los ámbitos de aplicación de la nacionalidad cubana con un proyecto de ley de base que en su apartado principal establecía que serían cubanos, cito, los nacidos dentro o fuera del territorio de la República de padres cubanos. La atribución de la nacionalidad a partir del principio del ius sanguinis hacía más difícil definir quién podría ser considerado cubano, ya que hasta entonces no había existido una categoría jurídica de ciudadano cubano. De hecho, las leyes españolas habían considerado como súbditos españoles a todas las personas nacidas en la isla. Además, esta ley proponía una concepción restringida de la nacionalidad, atada a elementos adscriptivos que excluirían una parte relevante de la población de la isla. Si convenimos que la denominación de padres cubanos indique las personas nacidas en Cuba de padres que habían permanecido allí de manera estable, la ley de base iba excluyendo del nuevo Estado a los ex-esclavos nacidos en África y a los españoles que habían vivido permanentemente en la isla. ¿Qué hacer entonces? Para obviar estos límites, otros comas de la misma ley conferirían la nacionalidad a los ex-esclavos nacidos en África y traídos en Cuba en los últimos años de la trata clandestina, a los emancipados, o sea, los africanos traídos ilegalmente en la isla, a los españoles nacidos en España y residentes en el territorio de Cuba el 11 de abril de 1899, y a los extranjeros nacidos en Cuba o residentes por lo menos durante 5 años. El conjunto de todas estas leyes permitiría a la mayoría de las personas presentes en Cuba ser parte del nuevo Estado. Pero el criterio del ius sanguinis sugiere una idea de nación atada al pasado, discordante con los ideales de igualdad que habían sido elaborados en las guerras de independencia. En oposición a este enfoque, Salvador Cisneros Betancourt, el expresidente de la República Cubana en Armas, presenta entonces un emendamiento que preveía la extensión de la nacionalidad a, cito su propuesta, Primero, las personas nacidas en el territorio cubano. Segundo, los hijos de padres cubanos, aunque nazcan en el extranjero. Luego, las personas que hayan estado en la revolución, cualquiera que sea su procedencia u origen. Luego, los extranjeros que tengan más de 10 años de arraigo en el país, siempre que así lo soliciten. Y luego, los que deseen naturalizarse conforme a las leyes que se promulguen sobre la materia. Según esta propuesta, con el criterio del jus soli, todas las personas nacidas en la isla podrían ser cubanos sin esperar la mayoría de edad ni manifestar explícitamente su consentimiento. Y la nacionalidad se otorgaría además a los hijos de los futuros inmigrantes. A diferencia de la ley de base, la proposición de Cisneros parecía abrirse más a la posibilidad de mezclas raciales y culturales y también en el futuro. Pero, ¿hasta qué punto? En conflicto con esta misma enmienda y con sus discursos sobre la igualdad, el mismo Cisneros añade, cito sus palabras, «No podrá por ahora el Congreso prohibir la inmigración o importación de las personas cuya admisión considere conveniente cualquiera de los estados que ahora existen, a excepción de la raza de color, que no deberá permitirse bajo ningún concepto su ingreso en la isla como inmigrante». ¿Cómo interpretar esta aparente contradicción? Podemos observar una concepción cultural de las diferencias raciales. Las personas de origen africano presentes en Cuba podrían ser incluidas en la nueva nación porque compartían con sus connacionales blancos el mismo grado de civilización y cultura. Hay otra enmienda presentada por José Alemán que propone, por ejemplo, impedir la inmigración de personas de color extranjeras porque, dice, no son ni alcanzan el grado de cultura de los de esta raza nacidos en Cuba y a quienes el país debe en gran parte la independencia por su esfuerzo personal y patriótico. Entonces, Alemán planteaba prohibir, cito sus palabras, la inmigración que no sea por familia de individuos extranjeros, blancos, a no ser que estos vengan para dedicarse a trabajos agrícolas. La inmigración de individuos de raza negra de cualquier procedencia y naturalización y la inmigración de chinos. Si confrontamos las limitaciones a la inmigración de raza negra con la contextual aceptación de la inmigración blanca, que debía ser por familias y dedicarse a trabajos agrícolas, resulta evidente que los discursos sobre cultura y patriotismo iban a justificar exclusiones de tipo racial. Porque la categoría de individuos extranjeros blancos era en realidad muy genérica para indicar personas con un determinado nivel de cultura y civilización. Y esto revela, de hecho, una mentalidad por la cual las personas de raza blanca eran consideradas civiles en cuanto tal, mientras que las personas de color podían ser incluidas en la nueva nación porque, permaneciendo en Cuba, se habían apropiado de un nivel de civilización y cultura que supuestamente no le pertenecía. En las actas de la Asamblea Constituyente, pero hay también otro enfoque que permitiría quizás contrastar las jerarquías fundadas sobre raza y origen y contrastar la inclusión subordinada de una parte de la población cubana. En la misma enmienda de Cisneros que he citado antes, hemos visto la propuesta de otorgar la ciudadanía a las personas que habían estado en la revolución. Hay otra ley, por ejemplo, que definía cual único criterio para que un extranjero pudiera ser presidente de la República, cito la enmienda, haber servido con las armas a Cuba en sus guerras de independencia 10 años por lo menos. Si consideramos esta perspectiva, el derecho a ser parte del nuevo Estado y de participar a su política se había conferido directamente en los campos de batalla y procedía de una relación de reconocimiento recíproco, sellada durante la independencia entre los que se decía entonces hicieron patria. eran derechos universales ya existentes, nacidos con la declaración de la República Cubana en armas, y deberían simplemente ser reconocidos en la Constitución. Manuel Sanguili, por ejemplo, defiende la propuesta de incluir el sufragio universal en la Constitución con estas palabras. Cito, lo que llama la educación política no nace de la asistencia a ninguna escuela especial, sino del tráfago de las luchas, de la experiencia en fin de la vida, en el curso y por razón de las vicisitudes políticas e históricas. ¿Qué revela esto? Revela una mentalidad opuesta a los discursos que hemos visto sobre educación y cultura y en favor de una idea igualitaria procedente de la solidaridad y participación política. Concluyendo, lo que puedo decir es que en las actas de la Asamblea Constituyente hay una tensión constante entre dos enfoques distintos de Estado y de Nación. Estos procesos, de hecho, fueron característicos no solo de la situación cubana, sino de las trayectorias que caracterizaron la construcción del Estado Nacional a partir del siglo XIX. Por un lado, hay la concepción republicana de la ciudadanía, que permite el reconocimiento entre iguales, y por otro, los que llamaban los factores espirituales, las identidades, la cultura compartida, que permiten identificarse y preservar una específica entidad estatal. En el contexto cubano, los criterios de nación fundados en la raza y la cultura delineaban, de hecho, una sociedad jerárquica funcional a la economía de plantación y que incluiría de manera subalterna a los sectores sociales más pobres y a la población de origen africano. Lo que podemos preguntarnos es, quizás la adopción del sufragio universal podría empujar una idea de igualdad relacionada con la participación política y podría constituir una barrera efectiva contra la exclusión de estos grupos sociales. De hecho, no todos los grupos lograron apropiarse de estos discursos surgidos en un contexto militar y transitados en tiempo de paz. Hay investigaciones que demuestran cómo algunos sectores de la población de color intentaron desarrollar, por ejemplo, otras estrategias de emancipación subordinada a partir de la asimilación de la cultura de origen europeo. Un'ultima palabra, bueno, por fin, dell'ambito politico estarían excluidas las mujeres, ya que la Constitución emanada en 1902 contemplaría solamente el sufragio masculino. Yo termino aquí, muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias, Lorena. Gracias, hay aplauso virtual. Muy bien. Bueno, si hay comentarios, si alguien quiere que se repita algo, si hay preguntas, please make yourselves visible, make yourselves audible. If you have a question or a comment or you want some information repeated from Loredana. We've got a good 9 minutes left before our next paper. Can I ask a question, Loredana?
Yes, of course.
And should we do it in English? Is that okay?
Okay, try. If I do not understand, I ask you to talk in Spanish, okay?
Okay, so thank you very much. Thank you for your paper. And you talked towards the end. My question was about women, but you answered that question right at the end. But could you say to us, could you kind of rephrase or reconceptualize for us how race, the question of race, intersected all of these different ideas about who belonged and who didn't belong in the state or the nation?
Can you please answer in Spanish?
Español. Vamos a hacerlo en español. Así que si puedes, a ver, darnos una reconceptualización o una explicación, volver a darnos una explicación de cómo el concepto de raza incide, interviene en la creación, la construcción de esos grupos identitarios y el sentido de pertenencia al Estado o a la nación, la raza.
Bueno, yo creo que el concepto de raza es central en todo. Yo me refiero a las actas de la Asamblea Constituyente, que eso, es el... que son los documentos que he analizado en este trabajo. Yo creo que el concepto de raza es central en toda la definición de lo que es la nacionalidad cubana y la ciudadanía cubana. Hay una tensión entre una parte de los constituyentes que está todavía atada al pasado, más atada al pasado colonial y entonces a las categorías raciales y sociales que habían sido utilizadas en Cuba hasta los años anteriores a las guerras de la independencia, y una parte de los constituyentes que han desarrollado o van desarrollando una mentalidad nueva, una concepción nueva de Estado, de nación y de ciudadanía que se ha ido formulando durante los años de, las guerras de independencia. O sea, bueno, me refiero, claro, al pensamiento de Martí, a la práctica de la igualdad racial que se va consolidando en los años de la independencia. Y estas dos concepciones luchan constantemente. En el debate se hay una lucha constante entre estas dos concepciones de raza, nación, ciudadanía. O sea, por un lado hay la idea de nación relacionada con la descendencia. Entonces el proyecto de ley de base que dice son cubanos los hijos de padres cubanos, pero hay un problema, ¿quién son los padres cubanos? Porque no hay ninguna ley anterior que hablaba, que contempla una categoría jurídica de cubanos. O sea, la categoría jurídica de cubano hay que inventarla mirando al presente y al futuro. No es posible inventarla mirando al pasado. Y entonces la concepción que intenta imponer la categoría jurídica de cubano mirando al pasado, mirando a los lazos de sangre, tiene muchos límites porque no permite incluir al mismo nivel en el nuevo estado toda la población que vive en ese momento en la isla. La otra categoría que contrasta con esta categoría que mira al pasado y que es la categoría que mira al presente y mira a las recientes guerras de independencia, es la categoría que dice hemos luchado todos juntos, hemos participado todos juntos. El reconocimiento como ciudadanos, como pertenecientes a una misma nación, ha sido sellado entre nosotros durante las guerras, entre los que hicieron patria. Esta frase, los que hicieron patria, es muy se lee muy frecuentemente en las actas de la Asamblea Constituyente. ¿Y qué quieren decir esto? No debe haber distinciones, no debe haber diferencias entre nosotros, pero lo que se ve en este trabajo, por ejemplo, es que también los miembros de la Asamblea Constituyente que proponen una visión más abierta, que aparentemente no considera las cuestiones de raza y de cultura, luego va a parar cuando se habla dell'assunto della immigrazione, va a tener límites, porque está bien las personas de origen africano que viven en Cuba porque han asimilado la cultura de aquí, han asimilado un determinado nivel de civilización, pero no podemos aceptar los europeos blancos, pero no podemos aceptar las personas de color por ejemplo de Haití y de Jamaica. Esto es lo que se intenta poner en la Constitución. De hecho, este intento va a fracasar porque en el arco de 15-20 años la economía de plantación de Cuba necesita mano de obra barata y esta mano de obra barata no puede que ser negra, no, o sea que es feo decir eso, pero es lo que pasa. Entonces hay ahí también hay una tensión entre una idea de estado, de civilización, de cultura y la realidad que es otra. Y entonces, ¿cuál es el resultado? El resultado es la inclusión subordinada de una parte de la población. No sé si respondo a tu pregunta.
Buena, muy comprensiva. Muchas gracias.
No, por nada. Bueno, gracias a ti.
Yo creo que hay manos alzadas, pero por favor, como vamos a ser estrictos, we're going to be trying to be strict with the time. And so... we're going to say thank you. Gracias, Loredana. If you would like
gracias
to ask a question in commentary, you have the chat space, okay? But if we could leave it until the end of the panel so that the speakers don't get interrupted by that, that would be great. So if you've got any questions, write them down, hold on to them, save them for the end and include them in the chat. Remember, we are recording and then this chat remains permanent, okay? So you can ask people to respond to your questions at any point in the future. Thank you again, Loredana.
Thank you.
Muchas gracias. So we are now going to move on to Steve Wilkinson. Steve, you're here. Do you want to make yourself visible? The other thing I'll say while Steve makes himself visible is that many people have left a written paper and I've uploaded it to the team's files. So if you want to go back and look at Loredana's more detailed paper, please.
I'm trying to be visible. I don't know whether people can see me or not.
Yes, we can.
Okay, good. Hi, everybody. Great to see you all again after all this time. See some familiar faces.
So, Steve, let's introduce Steve. Steve's paper, he's got 10 minutes and then 10 minutes for questions. A Tale of Two Nationalisms, Discourses of Race and Class in the Origins of Raceless Cubanidad. And again, Steve's paper is available for you to read at your leisure on the files attached to this team. Over to you, Steve.
Thank you very much, Pa. So I'm not going to try and read the paper or present it in full. I'm going to talk to it and some of the ideas that are in it. Essentially, I started out by I had the idea of researching a biography of Juan Gualberto Gómez, who was the deputy leader of the independence movement under José Martí and a very close collaborator with Martí. And the reason why I did that was because I realized that there wasn't really a biography of Juan Gualberto Gómez in English. And the one biography that exists in Spanish was, I think, written by his niece and is really rather a eulogy to him and not terrifically objective. So I thought there was a big gap there that could be filled. So I started researching the career of Juan Gualberto Gómez, who, as you know, was the son of a slave and really one of the most prominent black intellectuals and journalists of the late 19th century and early 20th century, and very much an integral part of the independence movement. And indeed, while Martí was in exile, if it hadn't been for Juan Gualberto Gómez, it's arguable that the revolutionary movement within the island would have perished. And so his particular contribution to Cuban independence, I thought, was rather neglected to some extent. Although, of course, there is an airport named after him in Cuba, and he is honored in Cuba. I didn't feel as though he was given perhaps the attention that he ought to have had. So I began to look at his career, and I realized that he was very much not only the defender of the idea of a raceless Cuban nation, he was one of the originators of the idea. And it occurred to me that this concept of being neither black nor white, but only Cuban, which is attributed to Martí, was somewhat perhaps over-attributed to Martí, and that there was actually a very strong contribution to this idea that came from the black intellectuals at the time. So I started to look into this, and then I realized that there seemed to be, to me, a discourse which seemed not only rather white, but also rather bourgeois in the historiography of the revolution and this idea of a raceless Cubanidad. And the reason I say that is that looking at the historiography, you find that there is an almost universal acceptance that the concept began in the 1868-78 war, and particularly with the action of de Céspedes, who freed his slaves in order to fight against Spanish colonialism. And it is argued very strongly by even very, very, very good historians like Ada Ferrer, for example, that the idea of a raceless Cubanidad originated as a consequence of the praxis of the 1868-78 war, in which freed slaves and whites fought side by side in order to liberate Cuba, and that afterwards it was a rather enlightened leadership under Martí that decided that this was a good idea, that they should create an ideological formation which would bring a united, raceless nation together. And it occurred to me that this perhaps was a mistake. And the reason for that is that it occurred to me that there must have been a concept of a raceless nation that existed before it, particularly in the minds of black insurrectionists and people of color, mixed race insurrectionists, prior to the 1868 war. It seemed illogical to me that it wouldn't exist. So I started to look again at the historiography, and I found that indeed, in the very early years of the Cuban Revolution, an attempt was made by particularly black historians to revise the history. I'm talking about Walterio Carbonell, for example, who attempted to actually rescue the idea of a raceless Cubanidad and subscribe its origins much earlier than 1868. In fact, right at the beginning of the 19th century and amongst the leaders of rebellions of slaves much earlier in the century, and of course inspired by the Haitian Revolution itself, which of course it seems to me to be absolutely crucial to this. And so I've kind of written a historiographical article which argues for a revision of the historiographical accounts of the origins of a raceless Cubanidad. And I think I've found significant enough evidence to argue that, in fact, certainly in the Aponte Rebellion of 1812, there was a pretty strong formulation of an idea of wanting to end slavery, but also create a republic like that which had been attempted in Haiti, in Cuba, which would be afford rights to all, regardless of race. And then in 1821, in the Solisi Bolivar insurrection, which was very widespread across Cuba, there is certainly strong evidence to show that the leadership of that rebellion also was articulating an idea of a republic that would be raceless in the sense that we think of it later in the century. And there was also a black African uprising, which has been written about by Manuel Barcia in his book, 1825, where there is very strong evidence that the leadership of the slaves were inspired by the Haitian Revolution. And of course, you have to remember that the Haitian Revolution produced a constitution which gave rights to all, regardless of race, for the first time in history. So my argument is that although I've got no conclusive evidence to support this, there is very sufficient circumstantial evidence. And part of the problem is that the the dominant historical discourse on this has, of course, been basically predominantly written by white historians and from sources that are indubitably also white. The record that we have of the intentions of the insurrectionists from this early period is very sparse indeed, because of course they were largely illiterate and therefore left no written records. And the only written sources that there are were compiled by interrogators of the survivors of the insurrections who were captured and then questioned under torture. And therefore their accounts are really rather untrustworthy. So it's very, very difficult to find the evidence, hard evidence, to support this. But I think the circumstantial evidence is certainly there. And there is considerable amount of writing by historians, Cuban historians, from the 20th century, prior to the revolution and immediately after it, which support this argument. And that I'll point to two, Walterio Carbonell and Jorge Ibarra, both of whom argued very strongly that the idea for a raceless Cubanidad came from below and not from above. And I think that in and of itself is something that needs to be foregrounded now. And in the context of Black Lives Matter and so forth, I think we need to revisit the historiography of the 19th century and start a project to revise it in this way.
Steve, thank you very much, not least for keeping completely perfectly to time. So thanks, that's fantastic. I'll remind you that his paper, which has been accepted for publication. Can you just say a little bit more about that before we go into questions?
Well, it's in review, but I've been given more or less assurance that it will be published in the Journal of Caribbean History.
Great. So over to questions. If you can unmute yourself, make yourselves visible. Questions for Steve. We've got a full 10 minutes or comments. Don't be shy.
Oh, can I have a question? Yes. Thank you.
You can award yourself
first. Steve, have you found any much evidence of the opposite view in the rebellion, in the forces, the rebel forces of 1868-78. I ask that because the Guaymaro Assembly is quite notorious for being silent on abolition and also even silent on the question of annexation. And annexationism itself was actually driven by the desire to keep slavery. So there was a strong element, at least among white leaders, among white activists in 1868-69. But I wonder if you found any evidence of those who actually didn't agree with the idea of black and white fighting together and therefore in the end being equal. I mean,
this is dealt with by Ada Ferrer very well in her history of the war, and I recommend it actually. The reason why the war, you know, it resulted in the end in being more or less a defeat for independence was because the Spanish very successfully used racism to divide the forces. So the counter argument that you refer to, Tony, was very evident and was manipulated and used by the Spanish in order to sow division, because there was a racist, white racist element within the insurrectionary forces that were willing to sell slavery out, if you like, or the abolition of slavery out. And that's why it divided the way it did. And one of the reasons, of course, why Maceo is regarded as such a hero is that he was the one general who refused to give in to this argument. And maintained the revolution by refusing to accept the Peace of San Juan. But essentially, yes, there was a very strong element of that. And towards the end of the war, Ferrer talks a good deal about the way in which black officers were marginalized by the leadership increasingly as the war came to an end. And blacks were kind of pushed back down, if you like, for want of a better term, by the leadership. And that's why afterwards it's argued very strongly that this lesson was learned by Marti, that you couldn't do it without the black element. They needed to unify the movement racially in order for it to succeed, because it had been divided successfully by racism at the end of 1878. So that's one of the reasons, actually, come to think of it, where I kind of got this logical argument from, and that was that it must have been the black element that wanted the racelessness, not the white element. It doesn't make sense for it to have come from the white section of the movement. It had to come from the black section of the movement. The demand for abolition of slavery was theirs, but also for the creation of a society which would abolish racism must have come from the blacks, not the whites. It doesn't seem logical otherwise. And so therefore I looked back before 1868 for black insurrectionary movements. And incidentally, there was, this intermediate strata or class of free men of color who were actually the real protagonists in many of these rebellions, because they had actually achieved certain rights under the Spanish rule, which were being denied them by the plantocracy that developed after the Haitian Revolution around sugar. And their status was being undermined. And therefore, they began to side with blacks in order to form movements to overthrow the white plantocracy. And that's where this movement for an independent Cuba that would be for all, regardless of race, originated. And it must have originated in the black and mixed race population and not the white. And my point is that the historiography points always to this enlightened, liberal, white, middle class element that seems to have been given this wisdom to have seen the necessity for this unification as being the source of this idea of a raceless Cubanidad. And my argument is that it must have come from below, and it must have come from classes of blacks and free men of color, as they were called, prior to that.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Steve. So we've got another 4 or 5 minutes. If anybody else has any questions or comments, please just make yourself visible. All right, somebody's used the chat.
Yeah.
Can you see that, Steve? How do you read the reception?
Well,
it'd be easy to ask the question directly.
There has been work done on this. Kate Quinn has written very well on Carbonell and what happened to the revisionist movement of black historians in the early part of the revolution. And again, I have to say that the picture isn't particularly great. There was, I would say, a repression of this particular voice in the 1960s. The revolution wanted to actually, well, adhere to what I argue is a very white bourgeois version of history. And so Carbonell was marginalized. And of course, he had, by all accounts anyway, some issues, mental health issues, which were then used against him. And he suffered a marginalization, and it has to be it is at the hands of the revolutionary intelligentsia, I have to say. So there was an attempt at the early part of the revolution to address this problem. In fact, a series of articles were published called Historia de la Gente sin Historia, which was trying to redress this lack in the canon of any kind of recognition of the contribution that blacks made to the independence movement. But that was lost in the latter part of the 1960s and the early 70s, I'm afraid. So, yeah. Can't hear you.
Sorry, Rosie, do you want to go ahead and just ask your question directly without using the chat? 2 minutes.
I think that was me.
Is that all right if I ask?
Yeah.
Ruby, you've jumped in ahead of Rosie. No, sorry, it's Ruby, RS. Sorry, go for it.
Yeah, it wasn't the same. That was fascinating. A fascinating presentation. I wanted to kind of ask about, you know, you were talking about the kind of race with Cuba, and at various points how it was kind of, black historians and different authors were trying to bring it back to the fore. I wanted to ask a bit about like the current kind of conception of raceless Cuba. You know, you raised about like the Black Lives Matter movement, and I saw an interesting video that was on Belly of the Beast Cuba that was about black Cubans talking about you know, the fight against racism in the US. And yeah, I just wondered, like, do you know much about what's happening in terms of, I don't know, like, you know, mobilizations or consciousness raising that's kind of currently happening by, you know, prominent black Cubans or anything? I just would be interested in hearing about that. Thank you.
Well, I'm not that familiar with the right up to the moment. I have to apologise with what's currently happening on the island, but I do know that recently there's been a resurgence, if you like, of interest in this, and in particular a desire amongst people in Cuba to redress the balance. And adopt a much more proactive approach to dealing with some of these lacunae that exist, which have to be as a consequence of an implicit racism that still exists. You know, it can't be ducked, and it mustn't be, in my view. We have to address this head on. I think that it is happening in Cuba. It probably could move faster than it is, but I do think there is a willingness to do that. And it has to be said, of course, that if it's going to happen anywhere, it'll happen in Cuba first. I think the progressiveness of Cuban revolutionary ideology in this regard will ensure that this happens in Cuba. I'm confident.
So thanks, Steve. I'm going to just call things to a close for this particular paper. And to alert you, Ruby, and other people, that Rodrigo Espina has left his paper. It's available to you on files, and he's talking about race in contemporary Cuba. And also, he's hoping to add an audio to that between today and tomorrow. So there will be more discussion about the topic of race in the next few panels. I'm going to pass over to the person sitting next to me, and that's Tony Capture, and share his PowerPoint. So, Tony, who's going to be talking about, well, the title of his paper, What Exactly Has La Revolución Actually Meant Over the Decades? Right, here we go, and here we are. That, right, Tony, I'm going to take it away.
Okay. I can start with an apology, actually, to anybody who heard an earlier version of this paper at the conference in November in Halifax, Nova Scotia. It has moved on since then, so it's not identical, but bear with me.
Can you all see the PowerPoint? Somebody unmute and say yes.
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 Thank you very much.
And I'm that the first slide makes it clear why I actually think it's significant issue, because of the confusion. I talk about the profusion and confusion, different people using different terms or different terms differently. For me, it's actually expressed above all by the fact that the 60th anniversary, for example, just like the 50th, was celebrated or commemorated outside Cuba by and large as 50 or 60 years since the revolution. In Cuba, of course, it was 50 or 60 years of the revolution. But that is just an illustration, I think, of the big difference between them. It actually goes on forever because I come across students all the time who really cannot distinguish between the two, or at least two versions of revolution. But it actually, I think, tells us something. And I give you here four different examples of the different uses of revolución, which you're familiar with. Triunfo de la Revolución, standard stuff, looking back, saying it has come to pass. It actually therefore refers by and large to what has happened up to 1959. Indeed, it's a quote from Fidel on the 1st of January, 1959. 1960, the Revolución has ceased to be something necessarily just simply in the past, and it's now something that can be defended. A year later on, of course, it's something within which you can belong, to which you can belong, and which therefore contains people, contains something. And then you move five decades on, Raúl comes along and says, I've not been elected in order to destroy the revolution. So the revolution, five decades on, is something that can be destroyed. There's a big shift from some 1959 version to the 2008, but the interesting thing is how quickly it develops in the early 60s. And this slide, I'm not going to go into the detail on this, it just simply talks about those differences between them. The difference between a process before, a process after, and the extent to which that was maintained. The interesting thing about this 1961, of course, is that by 1961, La Revolución had another meaning, which is something that was betrayed. The interesting thing, however, is when you look to see what was betrayed, and it's not clear because there isn't a consensus. And I argue that it actually is a view based very much on what I call here the common usage in political discourse. I except from this, Martí's Partido Revolucionario Cubano, which really did propose a revolution very clearly, but in many respects you find examples of revolución being used to describe and self-describe essentially armed rebellions against a government, normally with a moral, as I call it, redemptive action, to cite Lilian Guerra. And I think the interesting thing also after 1933 is that the adjective revolucionario is once again appropriated. Auténtico, the PRC Auténtico is the classic example, but all those bunches as well, MSR, ARG and so on, using the term revolucionario to give an element of legitimacy. And I think it's that general view of the indeterminate revolution that was shared in 1958 of what the July 26 movement meant. Now, of course, I mentioned 1961. 1961, we find the famous Declaración del Carácter Socialista de la Revolución. I actually would argue, as I go on to argue here, it actually confirmed rather than launched socialism. Remember that what Fidel actually says is no nos perdonan, lo que no nos podemos perdonar es que estamos haciendo una revolución socialista. In other words, it was already going on. But the declaration of socialism nonetheless, the confirmation of it, has an interesting dissent. Dissent obviously from those who logically would you would expect to oppose it in 1958, 59, 60, people I am referring to there. The third one is really interesting for me is the Partido Socialista Popular, the Communist Party, which met some of whom openly, or less openly, most of them, really felt that the revolution could not be, theoretically could not be socialist. Therefore, for them, it was not a revolución socialista. And I think that's really interesting because when, of course, the party is created, the first party is created, it's Partido Unido de la Revolución Socialista. It's a defiant declaration. So it's shifting. Shifts even more in the 60s, of course, by which point La Revolución becomes communist, becomes a process of deep and rapid change, quite explicitly communist, as you can see in the title of the party there, very clearly now based on, rhetorically at least, on el pueblo and las masas, and under siege. It's revolutionary in all senses, except then, at that point, comes 1968, which brings a new dimension, which is the admission of Cien Años de Revolución, celebrating 100 years from 1868 to 1968. Now that is really interesting because it's looking back to La Revolución's Cuban heritage, and it's seeing socialism and the current revolution as the culmination of those previous revolutions from 1868, which is, of course, the triunfo, but the triunfo of a revolución, always now capitalized as nation building and not simply as one version of socialism, one version of communism. It actually has a heritage quite clearly. And so that's the point, I think, when La Revolución becomes much more clearly and explicitly nation building. Now, the following 2 decades, of course, is a system. It's referred to as institutionalization, and that makes sense in all respects. But when revolucionario then becomes actually not a revolucionario, it becomes a good citizen of a system which is delivering goods, which is delivering a stable state, and has achieved some of those things. That's what it's officially, at least, in celebrating. But the interesting thing was, but if it's less a process, and it was more obviously less a process in the 70s and more static, was it less a revolution? Had the revolution ended? I suggest here that many people on the left outside Cuba at that point started to say, actually, there wasn't a revolution anymore. Some of them had said it at the start, but they were now saying, okay, the revolution stopped. Now, if the revolution stopped, of course, the point is in the 90s, you come across a very clear example of where the revolution was assumed to be stopping. It had to be saved. The revolution was under threat. It had to be saved at all costs. But by 1994, it was very clear that La Revolución was explicitly equated with Patria and Nación. It demanded unity. This is when you talked about salvar la patria, la nación y la inmigración. Casa de la Nacionalidad, nation had come into its own very clearly. But the interesting thing, of course, at the time was that at exactly that time, many people saw La Revolución as something in the past, a failed project, an anachronism. And the Hombre Nuevo idea now starts to be demystified, debunked. There was, however, I would argue, a big debate going on inside Cuba about what do we mean by the revolution, what do we mean by La Revolución, and I suggest 3 or 4 versions of it emerged from that debate. There is what was being proposed at one time, what was being proposed or experienced at another time, and what was also experienced at a third point. The interesting thing for me is that when the Latin American Pink Tide, which we should remember were often veterans of the 1960s left, started to look to Cuba as a model, it wasn't for any of those, it was actually for survival. And I'll finish by saying something else, which is just simply that what happened after in the period of the Batalla de Ideas is this quote from Fidel. I'm not actually used to quoting Fidel very much. In this particular case, he got it exactly on target, in as much as what he says there, if you look at those, I don't read it now, but look at it in your own time, it's what the speech he made on the 1st of May, which is now repeated endlessly in Cuba, especially by young Cubans who are asked to recite it and learn it. It is, for me, actually the classic combination of all those bits of definition that came in the previous 5 decades. And what I'm saying, argue here, and I'll finish on this, is it's mixing ideas, principles, values, and codes of behavior. For me, that's the interesting one. It's guía de acción, mixing definitions. And I think in many respects, what he was doing was ending that debate and starting the Batalla de Ideas by saying, this is what it actually is. And incidentally, he doesn't define it as the ideology of, or the meaning of La Revolución, just simply Revolución. I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Tony. So over to you for questions, comments.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sort of. Yeah.
Could I just make a comment? I mean, I thought that was a massive sweep over a long period of time and loads crammed in, which was excellent. It occurred to me as well that there could be a sort of parallel narrative about what is meant by counter-revolution, which has also changed in that period. And you know, the sort of Gisanos in the beginning when people left, and then as that other people who left had different reasons for changing. Partly that's one of the reasons, but obviously other reasons too. And what counter-revolution is, how that definition has changed during that period as well. I mean, it's just a thought that occurred to me as you were speaking, that's a thing that also would be interesting of attention. That's it.
Okay. I think you're right. It actually is really interesting because, and it, the point, it starts in a way, actually, weirdly, at Marielle, when the emigrants start to be referred to briefly as emigrants, or at least assumed to be emigrants. And then it becomes really clear in the 90s, early 90s, with Nación y Emigración, quite explicit, and the distinction between those emigrantes who are not politically motivated and those who are more economic ones, for example, and the old regime. So, yeah.
Right, the hand up, Ruby. Is there anybody else who'd like to ask a question? So unmute yourself, make yourself visible, ask a question. We've got a good 6 minutes.
Over to you, Ruby. Nope.
I think that was, I think that might have been from before. Okay. But yeah, that was very interesting. I was struggling to keep up with everything, but I'm going to read through the stuff after because it was really interesting. So thank you.
PowerPoint is available to have a look afterwards. So other people, questions or discussion? Anything else that you want to comment on?
This is Arnold here.
Excellent, Arnold. Do you want to make yourself visible? It would be great to see your face.
Just a second, please.
Don't worry about it. Video camera icon.
There you are.
I am visible. Okay. That was great, Tony, as usual. I have a question with regards to the current situation in Cuba and the term revolución. And this period when, you know, we cannot travel to Cuba, where I use my visits to get a read on the pulse of the situation there by exchanging with my Cuban colleagues over, you know, a long period of time. I use social media a lot, and it helps to find out what's happening there. The recent experience was that Gerardo Hernández was just recently named head of the CDR mass organization, and I put, you know, various things on the online on my Facebook, and one of the Facebook posts that I put online is I found a photograph of a barrio in Cuba that says "En cada barrio revolución." I posted it, but I noticed I got very few likes from Cuba on that. You know, I wasn't surprised because by doing so, I also was running, doing something, going against the tide because they have so many problems? How are they dealing with the issue of the revolution? But I'd like to have your view on how come there were quite a few likes from outside of Cuba, but with inside of Cuba, it was, you know, silence on that, and cada barrio revolución. What's your view?
It's interesting because one of the things I didn't have time, obviously, to talk about is something that we noticed after Fidel's death. The younger Cubans, particularly, but not exclusively, had a sense, or were expressing a sense, that La Revolución actually has another definition, which was, it is historic, it is in the past. The historic generation has finished now, and therefore, whatever is happening now is going to be something different one way or another. Now, they're not explicitly saying La Revolución is defined differently, but equally, they're not necessarily referring to it as La Revolución. That is beginning to emerge now, I think. So in a sense, what you picked up with your non-likes may be picking that up.
Right, 3 minutes left. Marisa's got a hand up. Could you put your hand down after you've asked your question? Marisa, would you like to ask a question?
Okay, yes, thank you. I'll try to be quick. So I'm just interested in the revolution as a code of practice and how that's changed, and wondering how the changes in that definitions might be experienced or might have been experienced on the island, and whether it might have caused some confusion in terms of the various definitions and ways of doing things, the correct way of doing things.
I think it's really absolutely on the right point there, because one of the things that's interesting when you look at all those little things mentioned in that speech, in that one paragraph, which is always quoted, it is a mixture of things, and it's very difficult not to agree with something in that, because it is not the revolutionary version of motherhood and apple pie. Everything's in there that you could want, so you can take something out of it. But also, unlike most of the other things, it actually is talking about codes of behavior, how to behave towards your fellow citizens. And it's not specific. It is really isn't specific. The Constitution, for example, was much more specific about what rights people had and so on, as you'd expect. But I think in some respects, the more vague the ideology, and Fidel was actually very vague in some respects, or at least comprehensive there, the more powerful it can be, because people can customize it. People can take what they want. That's why I find it really interesting, because it doesn't, it says everything, but actually says whatever you want it to say in some respects.
Okay, thank you.
Excellent. So we have time for one very, very brief question or a comment. Alf, you have your hand up. Alf.
Yeah, I think it's just a comment to say that I believe that there is an idea of continuity in Cuba. Somos continuidad is not a vain slogan, and that is now appearing in many, many billboards in and also in the literature of Cuba. And I think that's very important to see that Jazz Canel is somebody who has been inside, within the revolution, as a youngster, as a leader, young student leader. And I think that continuity is the one where the accent is being put right now, to show that there is still things going on, it's still the same objective, it's still the same struggle, it's still the same defense of the revolution, it's still unity of the people. I think that's important to emphasize that as well. Thank you.
Yeah, I think you're right. And I think that in a way, one of the things that the way I see that the fact that that statement of Fidel is actually constantly repeated all over the country and recited, it's almost like an article of faith. It's almost like what you say to persuade people, what you say to remind people. That continuidad is, I think, the same thing. It's reminding them. And it isn't necessarily what everybody feels, of course, but nonetheless, it's there. It's the official, it's the public rhetoric.
Excellent. We are working like clockwork. It is quite amazing, and the technology has served us well so far. So could I just remind Alpha, Lauren, Arnold to put your hands down? Your hands will get very tired, otherwise your arms will get tired. Okay, and we're going to move on to our next panel, which is Cuba in the international context. Cuba dentro del contexto internacional. Could I ask people to make themselves visible, the panelists, most importantly? So Patricia Calvo, do you want to make yourself visible? Oh, Mervyn Bain, who is flexibly on time. Wonderful.
Could we ask others who are not speaking, by the way, to close their camera, because it's getting very confusing having lots of people other than the panelists.
So we have Patricia. Hola, Patricia.
Hola.
¿Qué tal?
Bien.
Mervyn, you've just arrived.
Yeah, hi, hi, Hoojing.
Excellent timing, well done. And Arnold, you're already here. Fantastic. So we can have some cameras on, but certainly Mervyn, Patricia and Arnold, could you have your cameras, your video on so that we can see you as a panel as we would in real life? 10 minutes thereabouts per person plus 10 minutes for questions, discussion per person. Okay.
Patricia?
Hola. Sorry, I'm here.
Okay, well, I'm going to use your PowerPoint. Is that okay? Would you like me to? Yep.
Sorry?
I'm going to share my screen, which is your PowerPoint, yes?
Yes, okay. Just asking for that, because I need to show my graphics.
Okay, so, all right, let's go back to this and share screen. Okay, we don't need computer sound. That is Patricia, right there.
Okay.
Do you want to tell me then when you want to change?
Okay, I don't know. I do yes, like next. This.
Next is good.
Next, okay. Excellent. Well, I will speak in Spanish because it's easier for me. So sorry, my English is not improved enough. So. Ok, bueno, como dice el título, voy a hablar de la revista Tricontinental en su primera década. Es un trabajo que forma parte así brevemente, de dos proyectos más amplios. El primero, bueno, de un trabajo que hacemos diversos investigadores bajo el título de Construir la identidad radical, los procesos de difusión en la conformación de un ethos revolucionario de nueva izquierda, ¿no? Y que próximamente pues, bueno, se va a publicar en forma de libro y en el que cual tengo un capítulo en inglés finalmente para que se pueda leer bien, como muchos me pedís siempre que escriba mis cosas en inglés. Y también forma parte de un proyecto personal de carácter postdoctoral acerca de la internacionalización de la dimensión pública de la Revolución Cubana a partir de la década de los 60. Entonces, bueno, la revista Tricontinental formó parte de ese engranaje, ¿no?, de construcción de la identidad revolucionaria. Si pones la siguiente diapositiva. Bueno, ahí es un poco de lo que voy a hablar. La siguiente, ya. Voy a ir un poco rápida porque tengo bastantes cosas que decir. Entonces, bueno, eso, la revista Tricontinental formó parte de ese engranaje de construcción de la identidad revolucionaria de la que estaba hablando y contribuyó, en cierta forma, a la expansión y difusión de ese ideario, ¿no?, a nivel internacional. Y la hipótesis de trabajo, para este análisis en concreto, pues ha sido verificar ese carácter tricontinental de la revista, pero atendiendo a ese leitmotiv cubano, ¿no? Sobre todo teniendo en cuenta que el secretariado ejecutivo de la organización de la OSPAL se radicó en La Habana y que la revista se confeccionaba allí. La siguiente. No me voy a parar mucho en el contexto, porque bueno, más o menos es conocido. Y de forma concreta diré, bueno, pues que tiene su punto de partida en la conferencia tricontinental celebrada en La Habana en enero del 66 y de donde surgirían pues la OSPAL, la Organización de Solidaridad de Pueblos con los Pueblos de África, Asia y América Latina, y la OLAS, ¿no? Ese gráfico que saqué de la documentación de la CIA, pues lo explica muy bien. Y bueno, citando a Tony Capcia, la conferencia tricontinental se organizó en La Habana para presentarse como aliado natural del tercer mundo y reforzar la línea cubana de confrontación con el imperialismo estadounidense a través de las armas. Y como veis ahí, la CIA, por su parte, pues decía que eran organizaciones para asistir y coordinar las actividades de grupos terroristas e insurgentes. Así que, de forma general, la revista Tricontinental vio la luz en un contexto de cambio, ¿no?, de paradigma en el interior de Cuba, que tuvo su reflejo después en el exterior. No obstante, la paulatina convergencia, digamos, con la ortodoxia comunista tuvo su contraparte en este nivel divulgativo que yo analizo, de difusión y de propaganda, digamos, donde la lucha armada sí que ocupaba un lugar preponderante. Next. Bueno, unos pequeños datos sobre la revista. La Tricontinental daba cabida a artículos teóricos de información y orientación de opiniones en la que se publicaban colaboraciones de los principales líderes políticos de los tres continentes. Según la última secretaria general de la OSPAL, Lourdes Cervantes, la revista nunca ha sido la hechura de un grupo de periodistas, ¿no?, sino que fue concebida para que la izquierda revolucionaria, la izquierda intelectual, los dirigentes y militantes políticos, así como los activistas sociales, pues fueran sus autores, ¿no? El último editor de la revista, Santiago Feliu, que me confirmó en una entrevista que le hice en La Habana el pasado mayo, bueno, mayo de 2019, cuando se podía viajar y estas cosas, que el modus operandi de la revista era la convocatoria, es decir, que se solicitaban artículos, y esta era una pauta que lo marcó ya, digamos, el primer secretario general de la OSPAL, Osmani Cienfuegos, por lo cual solicitaban los artículos a todos los líderes para incluir sus reflexiones en la revista. Siguiente. Esta difusión internacional se denota con la edición de la revista en varios idiomas, ¿no?, que serían el español, el inglés, el francés y el italiano en esta primera etapa. En 1982, en la propia revista se pone que se empezó una edición en árabe, pero que duró más o menos unos 4 números. Por su parte, la edición italiana duró hasta 1971 por parte de Feltrinelli, y la edición en francés fue prohibida en 1969 en Francia, a raíz de los sucesos, sobre todo de mayo del 68, en el que, en cierta forma, se acusaba a la revista de promover y alentar a los movimientos extremistas, ¿no?, sobre todo por las consignas que está ahí en la diapositiva, que aparecían en la contraportada de la revista, es como lanzar un cóctel Molotov, por ejemplo, ¿no? La siguiente, ya basándome en la información extraída del archivo de la OSPAL, que, bueno, no sé si sabéis que la cerraron el pasado año, de hecho yo estuve en mayo y en junio ya empezaron a desmantelar toda la organización. Y, bueno, los documentos nos muestran información en cuanto a la distribución, ¿no?, de la publicación en los dos primeros años de existencia, es decir, en 1967 y 68. Entonces, el gráfico que ahí podéis ver refleja el notable incremento de países y destinatarios desde el primer año al segundo. Voy a ir muy rápido. En el siguiente, en el función de las realidades geográficas que manejaba la ejecutiva de la OSPAL, se ve que a finales de 1968 el mayor incremento de envíos se produjo hacia Asia, seguida por los países europeos y árabes, y un menor incremento pues, hacia Estados Unidos y Canadá, América Latina y África. En el siguiente gráfico, pues eso, a pesar del... Si no lo veis ahí, que está muy pequeñín, está en los archivos compartidos, pero a pesar de eso, del aumento que comentaba de envíos a Asia, vemos que el mayor número de envíos se da siempre hacia Europa. Y después, bueno, sería Asia, América Latina, Estados Unidos y Canadá, África y los países árabes. El archivo pues, no contiene referencias a la evolución posterior, ¿no?, de esta distribución, así que se desconoce el tiempo que se mantuvo, si aumentaron la cifra o el momento exacto como preveo que decayó, ¿no? Sin embargo, estos datos pues, nos indican en un primer momento el esfuerzo, ¿no?, que se hace para la circulación de los materiales que estaban elaborando. Siguiente. En el archivo de la OSPAL también nos indica que los destinatarios de esos materiales se convirtieron en divulgadores, ¿no?, de sus publicaciones. Este gráfico pretende reflejar aquellos destinatarios que hacían circular los materiales, los que hacían intercambios, los que los redistribuían o los que publicaban, o sea, que los reproducían, ¿no?, en otras publicaciones. Y vemos que en África había una mayor tendencia a la redistribución, así como en Asia y los países árabes, y mientras que en América Latina, Estados Unidos y Canadá, Europa, se prefería, ¿no?, la circulación y el intercambio de los materiales. En el siguiente, el gráfico nos habla de los receptores de la revista. Se ve muy pequeñito, después si podéis verlo. Dejando a un lado la categoría de se desconoce, ¿no?, unknown, como pongo ahí, vemos que el sector intelectual y universitario es el que sobresale. Y esto un poco evidencia el carácter de la revista, ¿no?, donde los contenidos eran teóricos fundamentalmente. Y a la luz de los datos, pues resulta de interés en círculos académicos y principalmente europeos. En la siguiente, la segunda categoría que veíamos en el gráfico son los suscriptores, y esto, bueno, denota que es una revista que se obtenía previa suscripción y la mayoría era en Europa. Y bueno, aquí podéis ver los boletines de suscripción que se incluían en cada uno de los números de la revista. El siguiente.
Patricia, ya pasaste 10 minutos, te quedan 10 para preguntas y eso, ¿no?
Bueno, pues paso a las conclusiones entonces, porque me quedaba hablar de los contenidos de la revista y demás. Si me pones la penúltima diapositiva, la antepenúltima, para reflejar un poco las conclusiones, pues eso. Todo el estudio refleja eso, que sí existe una evidente tricontinuidad, pero desde Cuba, con el punto de vista cubano, de abogar siempre por la lucha armada, una intención divulgativa global, ¿no?, en varios idiomas y que tuvo calado, como acabo de comentar, en el sector intelectual europeo, que son textos producidos por los protagonistas, no era una revista de periodistas, son contenidos alternativos a la agenda de los medios, ¿no?, digamos, transnacionales, dominados de esa agenda por las agencias de noticias norteamericanas, sobre todo, y los principales contenidos pues, serían la lucha armada, el antiimperialismo y la solidaridad. Y bueno, se me han quedado muchas cosas, va a salir un capítulo de un libro y cualquier pregunta, pues adelante.
Perfecto, muchas gracias, Patricia. Lo siento mucho, me siento tenemos que estar así en ese plan, pero es así. Pero hay 10 minutos para preguntas, comentarios. Arnold, todavía tienes la mano arriba y hay una M, no sé quién es, con la mano arriba. Otra persona que se haga visible, audible y que haga su pregunta. ¿No? ¿Alguna pregunta, algún comentario? Tenemos...
Hi, I'm sorry, I have a question, but I can't raise my hand.
Okay.
I'm sorry. Patricia, I was... Hi. Can I just go ahead? Sorry to interrupt. I was just really surprised by the amount of the publications that were destined for Asia and for the Arab world. I just wondered if you could elaborate on that a little bit. What was the... Why was there so many more publications going to Asia and the Arab world than, say, to Latin America? What was the... What do you know about the groups, the subscriptions, the destinations? I know that that's a big topic, but if you could just speak to that really briefly, I'd be very interested.
Okay, thank you. Si entendí bien es porque esa propensión a Asia, ¿no?
Sí, y el okay. mundo árabe, sí.
Okay. Perdón que voy a contestar en español, que me resulta más sencillo.
Sí, adelante.
Es que no me dio tiempo a hablar un poco de los contenidos, pero uno de los temas principales de, en esa primera década de la revista Tricontinental fue Vietnam. Entonces, Vietnam estaba, digamos, en el candelero y muchos protagonistas, ¿no?, de la lucha vietnamita aparecían en sus páginas. Entonces, en los archivos no pone nada de eso, pero bueno, a raíz del análisis de los contenidos de la revista y demás... porque tampoco había nombres de grupos concretos ni de, eso, de los grupos que actuaban, pues Vietnam eso estaba en el tema, o sea, estaba entre los principales temas a tratar, entonces esa puede ser una de las razones. Igual que a los países árabes, Palestina era otro de los temas que destacaban, ¿no? Estaban, lo pongo en una de mis diapositivas, después si lo puedes ver, estaba en ese top 10, ¿no?, de temas más tratados. Entonces, mi conclusión es que esos son los motivos, ¿no?, de que, del aumento de números de, hacia esas zonas o esas regiones.
Gracias.
Hay todavía una M con la mano alzada, no sé quién será. ¿No? ¿Otra pregunta? ¿Otro comentario para Patricia?
I also have a question. I'm sorry, I was not able to raise my hand. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, fantastic. First of all, thank you so much for your presentation. And I'm going to ask my question in English, if that's okay. My question is about the networks of distribution for the magazine within the United States. I know that in the 1960s and 1970s, much of that distribution of the magazine within the United States was clandestine. But I wonder if your research touches upon any of that relationship in any way.
Ok. En Estados Unidos, Estados Unidos era otro de los temas importantes, ¿no?, de la revista, y además en una doble vertiente, en una vertiente de apoyo a la lucha de los Black Panthers, ¿no?, y de toda la lucha por los derechos civiles, que era como una forma de abogar o apoyar esa lucha armada dentro de las fronteras del enemigo, ¿no?, que digo yo. Y por otra parte estaba la denuncia antiimperialista, donde Estados Unidos siempre era eso, el malo, ¿no?, y era analizado y criticado desde este punto de vista. Entonces, la red dentro de Estados Unidos, falta por investigar, obviamente, pero había una serie sí, de publicaciones clandestinas que también Ramparts, por ejemplo, formaba parte de esa red. Que reproducían algunos textos de la Tricontinental, ¿no? De hecho, bueno, ese proyecto global del que hablaba en principio pretende pues, ver las conexiones, ¿no?, y las redes que existían realmente de esa circulación e intercambio entre publicaciones de, bueno, pues, de Nueva Izquierda o Izquierda Revolucionaria, como lo queréis llamar. No sé si contesta un poco la pregunta.
Yes, thank you so much. Okay.
Bueno, tenemos tiempo para uno más. más una pregunta, un comentario, más tres minutos, Patricia. Oh, Río Cabo. Gabriel, ¿tienes la mano?
Sí. ¿Me oyen?
Sí, si te quieres hacer visible, eso.
Sí. Hola, ¿qué tal? Gracias por la presentación, muy interesante. Quería entender que mencionaste que se dejó de editar en italiano en el 71. ¿Entendí bien? ¿Eso se debe a la muerte de Feltrinelli en la guerrilla directamente? ¿Usted ha investigado eso? Gracias.
Se debe, no está muy claro, porque de hecho hay una investigadora italiana que trabajó más el tema de la revista, de la versión en italiano, y de hecho desconocen, la misma investigadora dice que desconoce las causas por las cuales se dejó de editar en Italia. Y de hecho también le sorprende, que bueno, también lo pongo en mi capítulo, le sorprende que en las páginas de la revista no se haya mencionado ni la muerte de Feltrinelli, cuando bueno, Feltrinelli viajó varias veces a Cuba y mantuvo relaciones y bueno, los derechos del diario, y etcétera, etcétera. Entonces es un punto aún que está por investigar, y eso, los propios investigadores que están trabajando desde la edición italiana le sorprende, y es verdad, en la revista no existe ninguna mención a la muerte de Feltrinelli. Conforme, como he puesto, cuando se prohibió la revista en Francia, pues salió ese aviso, ¿no? En las primeras páginas, conforme pues se había prohibido y todo lo que conllevaba esto.
Interesante.
No te oigo, Par, tienes apagado.
Sí. Perdona que haya sido tan así, tan deprisa, pero tu PowerPoint está con tanto detalle. Sí. Y está en los archivos, entonces puedes
hacer lo que quieras, ¿no? Sí, cualquier cosa, pues me escriben y demás. Muchas gracias y felicidades por estar así un poco, o sea, un poco no virtual del todo, pero sí, nueva para todos.
Muy bien, gracias Patricia. Ok, so vosotros. We're going to move on to Mervyn. Mervyn, are you visible? Mervyn Bain? And while Mervyn makes himself visible, I'm going to find Mervyn's PowerPoint, unless Mervyn would like to manage that himself. Mervyn, what would you prefer?
I guess the way that you did it before would be perfect. So just
whether we can see your
for that. Again, thank you. I guess I'd just like to thank yourself and Tony as well for organising this. And I'm sure there's been a lot of challenges with the situation that we're in now. So thank you for everything that you've done.
Very nice, thank you. You're welcome. We're only half into the first day.
That's right.
So good. Don't jinx it yet, but over to you, Mervyn.
So far, so good, hopefully. Anyway, well, thank you as well. I guess what I was going to speak about just for the next few minutes is basically the relationship between Moscow and Havana, and how at the moment in 2020 it seems fairly politically robust, and possibly as robust since 1991 and the end of close relations with the end of the Soviet Union as well. But what I was going to argue, hopefully people have had a time to maybe look at the PowerPoint, is that the relationship is much longer than back to the period from 1960 to 61. So again, pardon me, just the next few slides are basically just examples of the contemporary relationship and how it's, you know, it's kind of robust nature at the moment. So obviously it's there, Diaz Canal was in Moscow in October last year. That's just a quote illustrating the nature of the relationship as well. And there's just different ways to show it as well. Again, Putin was supposed to be visiting Cuba this year, but obviously that's been delayed because of the other current situation as well and the various trips. So again, the next slide is just, again, further examples of the contemporary relationship as well. So obviously in trade, obviously it's a fraction of what trade was from 1960 to 61, but it's still increasing. I think that figure in 2018 is about double what it was in 2000 as well. And obviously another further example, Cuba trying to maybe export more to Russia, taking part in that first national exhibition of Russia with Cuban goods in Russia. Politically, I'm sure a number of you heard me say this before, and the relationship is beneficial for both countries in various international fora, how they can support each other being important. Always put a caveat to the next point. Obviously, at a reduced level again to the period from 1960 to 61, there's also an element of a military link as well, with you know, Raul Castro meeting the head of the Russian Navy earlier this year. So again, if we can just, sorry, Par, making you work hard at the moment, and the next slide is just further examples as well, also in culture and tourism. So just some examples. 2018, almost 200,000 Russians vacationed on Cuba. That's almost a fraction of the number of, say, Canadians, but still quite a large percentage of the tourists now coming from Russia. There's been opened up now an air route from Moscow to Varadero, so hopefully, well, I guess the desire at the time, before everything changed, was that more and more tourists would visit, or Russian tourists would visit Cuba. Also last year, for the first time, there was a Cuban Film Week in Russia as well, kind of just as a one very simple evidence of the cultural links as well. And just the last kind of couple of points as well about the contemporary relationship, also links between universities being important. And then the next point what was very interesting, what I'll come on and talk about later, is the last October when Medvedev was in Cuba, he visited the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier, and he referenced three Russians. And what's so interesting about that is those three Russians took part in the Cuban War of Independence in 1895. So therefore, it's the first kind of illustration about how much longer the relationship really, really is. 2009, Raul Castro did a similar thing in Moscow. He went to the permanent exhibition for the Second World War, where there was three Cubans fought in the Red Army in the Second World War. So just the relationship's much, much longer than that period, just from 1960 or from the Cuban Revolution onwards as well. Okay, so on the next slide, kind of trying to set it up as well, this is maybe some of the reasons you would see for the contemporary relationship being in the robust state it is. The fact that Cuba is looking for allies, and Moscow can be an ally in a number of different ways, trade, politically as well, helps obviously with the relationship with the US, and also maybe for trade purposes with Venezuela, as the level of trade with Venezuela has gone down as well. What I'd always wondered was, had the Soviet era debt been a block to trade with between the two countries, but has that block been removed? Well, it has been removed, but maybe trade hasn't increased to the level that I maybe had anticipated, but maybe in the future it will. Also a link to, as I mentioned a couple of times, that period from 1960 to 61, so obviously legacies as well. Also maybe aspects of Cuban and Russian foreign policy kind of coming together with common perceptions of global issues. Therefore, again, going back to that point about international fora siding with each other as well. Again, with a caveat, there's a geostrategic significance, obviously not the same to the Cold War, maybe at a reduced level, but Cuba has been very important for Russia's reassertion into Latin America, basically starting with the country it knows best. So again, it's these kind of legacies of the past and maybe commonalities running between the different periods as well. Okay, Par, sorry, if we could move to the next slide again, please. So therefore, as I've suggested, the relationship's got a much longer history just than to the period during the Cold War, from 1960 to 61. What had always traditionally been thought was Moscow had suffered from geographical fatalism towards Latin America as a whole before the Cuban Revolution. But what I would argue is that there was a relationship, and a much greater relationship, between the Russian Revolution of 1917 up to the Cuban Revolution of 1959 as well. And a number of these aspects are important as well. But what is key is the relationship that both countries, you know, Cuba, Soviet Union, now Russia, had with the United States being important as well. So again, I'm sure a number of you are just some examples. Bilateral relations between Moscow and Havana existed from October 1942 to March 1952. Bilateral relations were created the day after the United States joined the Second World War, obviously becoming an ally with the Soviet Union, again illustrating that important aspect of the relationship with the United States is well being important. Also, there had been sporadic trade had taken place between Cuba and the Soviet Union. During the Second World War, there was trade as the Soviet Union suffered, I guess, the fight against Nazi Germany. There had also been talk as early as 1921 of trade taking place. It didn't actually happen, but there had actually been talk of trade taking place. And also in 1955, Cuba sold sugar to the Soviet Union. There'd been an issue of overproduction in the Cuban sugar harvest, and the United States approved the sale to the Soviet Union. So again, demonstrating that significance of the United States. So it's just this much stronger relationship up before 1959 being important as well. Okay, Par, sorry, again, if you could move to the next slide, please, that'd be perfect. Also as well, just I guess briefly, again, I'm sure a number of you are aware that Cuban Communist Party created in 1925. That's quite late in terms of Latin America, but there's evidence as early as 1919 of information being or in the Third International Comintern Archive in Moscow about receiving information about Cuba as well, and how throughout the 1920s, but certainly the 1930s, the Comintern took a much larger interest in Cuba than maybe first anticipated, sending agents at various times being important as well. What I would argue for what drove that interest is the labor militancy of Cuba, really from the start of the 20th century. So therefore was the Comintern drawn towards Cuba because of that labor militancy, and maybe again that relationship with the United States. If the labor militancy came to fruition, could that help undermine the United States' interests in Cuba at that time? So again, really just really quickly about that Third International attention that they had in Cuba as well. Again, Park, could you maybe the next slide would be perfect. Again, just really, really quickly, there's also an Institute of Cultural Exchange based on the World Diplomatic Relations created in Havana. Most of the exhibitions, most of the information was Soviet information to Cuba, but it was also vice versa as well, with the second bullet point showing that as well. The Institute, as it states, published a monthly journal and hosted Russian classes, but again, what did it do? What was it doing? It was appealing to the progressive parts of Cuban society. It was basically an example of Soviet soft power at time. Why were they interested? Again, it's that role of the United States in Cuba as well. And then I think for the last time, Par, I think the final one to try and keep to time, it's simply that for the contemporary relationship, although geopolitics is very different to both 1960 to 1991 and the pre-revolutionary period, some of the pressures, particularly the role of the United States, has been key in all three, been key point as well. So although it's at a much reduced level, maybe compared to the Cold War, it's the unforeseen consequences of that US economic and political domination of Cuba drove that interest between the two countries as well. And just that the relationship is much, much longer than perhaps is traditionally seen to the 1960 to 1991 period. Okay, I guess that was a bit of a quick stop tour of everything, but hopefully I've managed to keep to time, hopefully with that. So thank you.
Fantastic, thank you, Mervyn. That's absolutely brilliant. So we've got 10 minutes. Well, we've got a greeting from Cuba, from Kenya Herrera, whose paper will be
tomorrow.
Saying, hola a todos, ¿qué tal el día? Provechoso. So that's lovely, but let's spend the next 10 minutes with Mervyn. So questions and comments from Mervyn. Can I just remind you, if you raised your hand at one point, Gabriel, Arnold, could you just make sure you put your hand down unless you still have a question? That would be great. If you want to ask a question, just go ahead and ask Mervyn, unmute yourself and make yourself visible.
Okay, thank you, thanks.
And brilliant timing, Mervyn, absolutely.
You can't always promise that, but thank you.
Questions?
I've got a question.
Sure, okay, hiya, how are you doing?
I'm good, thanks. You said there's more links that are kind of manifesting themselves at a university level. So I presume with undergraduates, is it postgraduates as well? Are they organising exchanges? What are they doing for those links?
Yes, it's exchanges. It's for a lot is for Cuban students to go to Russia as well. And what was really quite interesting as well, I mean, I really passed over it very briefly, is that there's now talk about trying to set up Russian language courses in Cuba, so that the students have the language training before they actually go to Russia. So it's really kind of at all levels as well. And that's obviously a throwback to what obviously you know a lot more than I do as well about the kind of cultural exchanges as well. But it's just really interesting. You've now got those language classes being spoken about.
So is it language classes so they can study a whole range of subjects? And absolutely. At the moment, is it just they're going to Russia to study Russian?
No, sorry. No. They're learning the Russian language in Havana to then be able to go to Russia to study other subjects. So it's just for that. So it's not just the Russian language in Russia, it's just to go to university and kind of more as normal to study different subjects.
Okay, cool. Thank you. That was my question.
Okay.
Other questions? We've got 8 minutes for questions or the comments. Arnold, do you have your hand up?
For some reason my hand goes up automatically. I'll try to control it.
I've heard a new horrible phrase. Is it a historical hand? I think it's a new horrible phrase, I think.
Let me just say a couple of things. Can I be heard? I'm not very technological. I cannot be seen because I don't have a camera. I'm not quite okay. Like that. So I just wanted to mention two things to Mervyn. And maybe he respond, but maybe he just wants to put him into his paper. One thing was you threw out the number of 451 in trade, 451 million in trade with Russia right now at the beginning. And I just wanted to say that it would help a lot if you, numbers don't mean much unless they're compared to something. And so the two things it could be compared to are the total trade that Russia, first of all, I assume that's imports plus exports. I don't know what it is. Yeah. And so you might, compare it to what the total trade, I mean, on the order of 20 billion, whatever it is, imports plus exports. So that would be about a 40th. So that's not very large. But anyways, set it. But even more interesting for your point, I think, would be to compare it to what the fraction was in some year that was pretty low, like the year 2000, when things were really low, and see how it's changed since then. It just might make that number more sense. The other thing I was just going to say, and again, to think about, and I certainly have no knowledge on this, but you were talking about what the effects were of ending the debt that was owed to the Soviet Union in 2014. And one thing just to think about then is that something else happened at about that same time that might have had a big effect. I mean, as you know, the Russian economy did disastrous in the 1990s and really grew very fast until the Great Recession. And after the Great Recession, it was doing quite well by international standards, less than before the Great Recession, but much better than most of the rest of the world until the sanctions were imposed. And I can't off the top of my head remember whether those were 2014 or 2015, but it was about that time. And so when you think about making an evaluation of how trade has been affected by removing the debt block, you're going to have to take that into account. And just off the top of my head, I can think of things going both ways. First of all, the Soviet Union grew less rapidly. Russia, sorry about that. We know we're talking to somebody who's kind of old, but he keeps using that term. Okay, so Russia grew quite rapidly, grew much less rapidly, and so that would have lessened the trade. On the other hand, the blocking of other trade options with Russia could have conceivably increased it going down. Anyway, those are just things to think about.
Okay, thank you. I mean, that's really helpful. Obviously, you're absolutely right about needing other figures as well. I mean, the figure, the trade's basically flatlined from about the year 2000, about 200 million of bilateral trade, which is both the imports and exports. What I always find it fascinating was in 1996, Russia was Cuba's largest trading partner. Which is just staggering. I mean, okay, it's a fraction of what it was under the Soviet period as well. Obviously, your point about it being a fraction of the total trade is absolutely apt, but it still makes Russia, but I think it's Cuba's about ninth largest trading partner.
Yeah.
So it's a fraction, but it's still important. So obviously, I should have contextualized that as well. Thank you as well for your comments about the bloc, because it's something I've always wondered about as well. In the whenever you looked at speeches, both sides are saying that, we want to increase trade, but why wasn't it increasing? So it was interesting that you always get this idea that, both sides talking about the trade increasing, but it hasn't actually increased. So that's really helpful. So thank you. Thank you.
Excellent.
Give something to think about.
Excellent. We'll move in. That's great. Thank you, Al, for your question. I think we have a hand up from Michael Tannen. Is that right?
Yes. Hello.
Go ahead. Hi.
Mervyn, I wonder what you think about something that somebody told me back in the 80s, a Cuban, when I was asking precisely the question about what is Russia's interest in Cuba. And one of the things they said was that Cuba was important to Russia because Russia didn't know how to speak to third world countries. This connects with what Patricio was telling us about Tricontinental. I wonder what you feel about that.
Obviously, I would like to talk about the Tricontinental. Obviously, I don't know as much, but I think you can certainly draw a parallel there to a more kind of contemporary period as well, about how when Russia started trying to reinsert itself into Latin America, it didn't really know how to do it. So therefore, where do you go? You go to the country you have the best links with, which is obviously Cuba. So therefore, there's maybe a parallel there. If you talk to Cuba, because of, you know, as we all know, Cuba's foreign policy and diplomatic relations with Latin America was a way in. So I think it's probably a parallel there that you could certainly draw to a more contemporary period. That once you have the relationship between Moscow and Havana, it can be used by Moscow to maybe help facilitate relations with other countries. So definitely, there would be an element of that there, definitely.
Thank you,
Michael. Gabriel, your hand is up. I'm just double checking that if we still have a couple of minutes, if you have a question that you wanted to ask.
No, I
don't see it as up. I'm sorry.
It's gone now. Your hand is down. And Al as well, and Michael, if you could put your hands down, that'd be great. I feel like a school teacher. What a life. So thank you so much, Mervyn. Thank you for being very, very prompt. Thank you for such an interesting paper. Again, Mervyn's PowerPoint with all of that detail is available for you to look at. And please don't forget, we are recording, so you can make this into a podcast. And as you go to bed every night, you can listen to 15 minutes of the Cuba Research Conference. On that note,
well, I just said that part. It wasn't my paper to put everybody to sleep at night. So.
Okay, first thing in the morning, let's rephrase this. First thing in the morning, you can start the day on the right note listening to the Cuba.
Okay, well, thank you.
Excellent, thank you. So now we're going to move on to Arnold. Arnold, if you could unmute yourself and just give me a second.
I am.
Hello, give me a second just to get your PowerPoint up.
Thank you very much.
Very welcome. So Arnold, do you want to read out the title of the paper?
Arnold's paper is The Cuban Press and Canadian Foreign Policy Canadian Foreign Policy Towards Cuba and Latin America, 2019.
Right, there we go. There we have it. Okey-doke, can everybody see that?
Yeah, just to, yes. You go to the next one. Next, Apar, you hear me? Next one. Oh, no, you've gone too far. Anyway, no. Second one. You get ahead, start. Okay, just to let you know, firstly, thanks a lot to Par and Tony for making sure this thing is actually happening. I know it's quite a challenge. Just to make sure that let you know that the title has been updated to include 2019. 2020, and based on my own experience directly within the Cuban press during this whole period that is very turbulent for the North America as well as South America and indeed the world. Par, next. Next, Par. Do you hear me?
Okay, I'm trying. Hold on one second.
Okay, there's no hurry.
It's not responding at the moment.
Let's keep trying.
Yeah.
That's the way to
let's
do it.
Let's do it
just like that.
Yeah. Is that okay like that?
No, we don't see it.
Sorry. We'll give you some extra time to make up for this. Since we're going
no on. Problem.
Right, so let's try now. Okay, that should be it.
Yes, you see it now.
That's it.
Okay, so you're going ahead too quickly.
Something's happening with it. I don't know what's going on. I'm going to try the arrows. Tell me when we get to.
Okay, so
here we are.
Okay, I guess we could start here. So I'll be dealing mainly with the Cuban press from within as I collaborate with one of the three main Cuban outlets, and with regards to Cuba's attitude towards Canada's policy towards Cuba and Latin America, but also interested in how the Cuban press deals with United Kingdom as well as the United States, if any one has anything on that point. Next one, please. Yeah, so when I talk about the Cuban press, I'm talking about GRANMA, the organ of the Communist Party, Juventud Rebelde of the Communist Youth League, and the third important one that prints a regular newspaper is Trabajadores of the Trade Unions. And next, please. Next.
It really doesn't.
Sorry, frozen again. Something
really happened. Doesn't want to do it.
Yeah.
So again, sorry about this. Let's keep.
Okay. One possibility, if it doesn't work, is you could hit the escape. You could have the screen be half the size, and you could just keep clicking on the thing itself in the left column. If you can't fix it the other way.
In other words, this one could be. We could skip this one to the next one. If you can do that, I could start.
Sorry. It's
just, okay, so how, thank you. How did I get connected with Trabajadores? In 1959, on the anniversary, 60th anniversary of the Cuban Revolution, January 2019, I did a very hard-hitting article with regards to Cuba's defense of its sovereignty in the face of what I call, next please, Par, of what I mention as the since World War II, United States has taken over the mantle of Second World War fascism, and Cuba has been standing up to this. And secondly, I also mention, I think you go to the next one, Par. Oops, we got stuck in.
We're having difficulty with this.
Your screen is just, your PowerPoint is just melting as we speak, but let's keep going. Let's keep it like that.
Okay. Yes, and so that's okay. And I also dealt with another controversial point, and that is the December 17, 2014, so-called thaw between Cuba and United States, saying that it was also a period where the United States or Barack Obama showed the cynical policy of opening towards Cuba, at the same time initiating the offensive against Venezuela. So next one. So anyways, this I noticed that at the time I got quite a few interesting comments by Cuban journalists with regards to that controversial article that I wrote back January 2019. However, none of the Cuban press actually printed it. But there was eventually one outlet that did print it. Go to the next one, please. Next slide, please. And that was Trabajadores. And what happened there is that when I saw that Trabajadores printed it, I asked in an email if during my next trip to Cuba, if we could have a meeting with myself and the staff of Trabajadores to explore the possibility of further collaboration. Next one, please. And then, of course, I did. I went to Havana. Was in Havana actually was part of a rapid. Next one, please. A rapid trip between Havana, Caracas, and Havana in February 2019. And when I showed up with that meeting, which I thought would be just an informal consultation with the staff there, it ended up being them asking me to give a talk, my view on the international situation, and specifically with regards to Canadian foreign policy regarding Venezuela. Next one, please. So this is this one I will read out because it was spontaneous. This is what I said. Normally, this is in front of Cuban journalists. normally, and this is a bit of a joke, I said, but we usually talk about solidarity with Cuba. That's true. But in this case, I'm asking for Cuba's solidarity with Canadians in the fight against this policy, against Trudeau's pro-Trump policy with regards to Venezuela could lead to actual military intervention. Now, next one, please. Next, yeah. However, I said it tongue-in-cheek, but it was very good news that the director and the staff of Trabajadores took it very seriously. Next one, please. And we worked out a basis of collaboration where I'll be writing regular articles for Trabajadores with regards to Canada's foreign policy towards Venezuela. Next one. And right from the beginning, the first one, I went to one of the main features, which is not that well known in Cuba, and that the so-called democracy that Canada is trying to promote towards Venezuela, whereas in Canada itself, the Canadian Trudeau government does not take into account the very strong labor movement in Canada that took a stand against Trudeau's pro-Trump policy in Venezuela. Next one, please. And so right off the bat, we hit this very good collaboration. And as things developed, I went even further and went on to the very sensitive issue, as everyone knows, the issue of Pierre Trudeau in Cuba. Next one, please. So the first time ever next one. In this article, I dealt with the issue of Pierre Trudeau and saying that it's very delicate, and saying that at the same time, I'm speaking on my behalf, and I'm not speaking, this is not the position necessarily of Trabajadores. Next one, please.
Arnold, do you want me to move it
on? Yeah, no, okay, that's fine. Okay, so anyways, with regards to that, leave that on, that's fine. With regards to that issue of Pierre Trudeau in Cuba as a sensitive issue, I wrote very clearly, giving my own view, that if knowing Fidel as a follower of Fidel in his thinking, no one can convince me that if Fidel was alive now in 2020, he would not have anything to say against Justin Trudeau's policy towards Venezuela. And that was printed as well as other, next one, please. And I also dealt very frankly with a very sensitive issue in Cuba, the relationship of Pierre Trudeau and Justin Trudeau, when I say very clearly, right, that family relations, whether it's in Cuba, England, United States, things change within generations. And this is an example. On the one hand, Pierre Trudeau, known for taking his progressive stand with regards to Cuba. And in the other hand, his son taking a stand more closely aligned to the United States, especially Trump, than any other previous prime minister of Canada. Next one, please. And then we start dealing with different aspects of the trade union and labor movement in Canada. For example, the uprising amongst the labor movement in support of Bolivia, in support of Evo Morales. Next one, please. And the pointing out how the Trudeau government completely supported Trump's coup against Evo Morales. Next one, please. And a lot of other examples, next one please, of how the trade union movement was very much involved in taking a stand against the Trudeau government. And also I introduced something that I'm sure would have been of interest and was of interest to Cuba, that is within Quebec, there's an important left-wing political party, which is not known. Next one please. And this political party actually issued a statement on, as a political party in the opposition in the Quebec National Assembly, which started off by quoting Eduardo Galeano. And so I titled that Eduardo Galeano in Quebec. Next one, please. Next one, please. And of course, here he is. They quote extensively the important quote for Eduardo Galeano. Next one, please. For the sake of. Okay, and also, for example, giving an interesting touch that was very much appreciated amongst in the trade union movement in Cuba, that the Canadian trade union movement put an interesting spin on the whole thing. A trade union leader went to Mexico, met with Evo Morales, came back and said, hey, the Canadian government, you should go and speak to Evo Morales to find out the truth about what happened in the elections there. Par, next one, please. And, you know, go ahead, next one. And I'm coming to a very important point, and that is, in Canada, Trabajadores, I was very happy they published our article showing that Canada, we in Canada, very strong grassroots movement amongst others by the Canadian Foreign Policy Institute, for which I am a fellow, we took a very strong stand against Canada's bid to have a seat on the National Security Council of the United States, of the United Nations. The other two candidates were Norway and Ireland. So we are happy that they printed it. And next one, please. They actually printed the petition that we had going across Canada and internationally to oppose Trudeau's bid for the United Nations. Next one, please. And as I said, despite all the pressures, and without going into details, there were and are a lot of pressures by what I call the apologists of Justin Trudeau to not report on our work within Canada and internationally against Canada's bid. Next one, please. So actually, we actually won that. Trudeau was defeated. It was an important event for us in Canada, and I think for people internationally, that a government that is so closely aligned with Trump should lose its bid to have a seat on the United Nations. And the outgrowth of this, I would say, is the second important event within several months in Canada. Cuba did not say anything about the Trudeau bid, but Venezuelan Foreign Ministry actively, by Twitter account, rejected Canada's bid for a seat on the United Nations Security Council. We wrote about that, and it was printed in Trabajadores. Next one, please. And just get me towards the end here. And the Arias, the Venezuelan Foreign Minister, openly tweeted with regard to that, joined with other people within the foreign ministry, and we reported on that, and Canada was defeated. Next one, please. This led to, I'm finishing with this one, if I have just two more minutes. This defeat of Canada led to the second important event in Canadian politics, fully reported on by Trabajadores. That is a Zoom conference held on August 20th with the main speaker, Arias, addressing for the first time in the history of Canada, a foreign ministry, another government, coming to Canada virtually and denouncing the Canadian government's support for Trump's coup attempts against his government. And we had thousands of people participating in it, and it was one of the most successful events that we had. Go ahead, carry on. Next one, please. Okay, and just to finish off with this, on that important event, I made sure that in the article that I wrote for Trabajadores, that I left no doubt about it with regards to Canadian role. I quoting extensively from Arias, who completely deconstructed Canada's false premise that they're in for humanitarian aid for Venezuela, that they have an issue with a so-called violation of human rights in Venezuela. And I added to that, quoting Bolivar, when he says, los Estados Unidos parecen destinados, that's me quoting in my article that I added on the basis of quotes from Arias, los Estados Unidos parecen destinados por la providencia a plagar la América de miserias en nombre de la libertad. And then I added that any Canadian, after, from our own experience, from our own investigation, and after hearing Arias, would say, okay, United States deserves that description by Simon Bolivar, but so does Canada. Next one. Actually, ending on there, you could read further on it. And of course, hopefully there'll be insights from participants from Cuba. You may have noticed that my articles have been dealt with substantially by Traveadores, but nothing in Grama and Juventud Rebelde. So perhaps this could be part of the discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Arnold. That's great. Sorry about the technical issues there.
No problem.
We are, however, merging seamlessly into the coffee break. So if you want to take 5 minutes of that coffee break, please feel free to switch off your videos, go make tea or coffee or whatever it is that you need right now. But if anybody would like to stay behind, and any comments or any questions for Arnold, please raise your hand or just make yourself visible and unmute yourself and ask your question. And welcome, Lawrence.
Can I ask a question?
You can. Can you make yourself visible? Is it Ruby?
Yeah. Can you see me?
Yeah. Well, we can't see you yet, but we know you got your hand up. Yep.
Thank you for that. That was really interesting as well. I just wondered, was the kind of, I found it really interesting what you were saying about the kind of pressures that there are around what they can kind of say about, Canada and other capitalist and imperialist countries. What was the kind of feeling before, or what was it about Canada before? From my understanding, it's similar in the same way to Britain, where there's lots of big, oil and mining companies that are lingering in Latin America that are from Canada. And also that, when you were talking about the policy towards Venezuela, and then it's recently been revealed that there's a secret department for regime change in Venezuela in Britain as well. I just wondered whether you could say more about how they kind of spoke about Canada before, or in other publications that haven't published your analysis. Thank you.
Yeah, well, we all know about, Canada has its own interest, mining interests, especially gold and banking, etc. And it does interfere in Venezuela as sort of a junior partner of U.S. imperialism, but with its own objective. As to why my articles are not published in Grama and Juventud Rebelde, perhaps the Cubans here can have some insight into it. But the basic view is that I would say it's sort of a conciliatory attitude towards Canada. Maybe the same thing takes place with regards to United Kingdom. Like, for example, perhaps one says that, Cuba becomes is critical of the Canadian government, then this will harm Canadian tourism. Some of my Cuban friends have told that to me, and I sort of whispered in their ear, and I said, hey, I'll tell you a secret. If you want to increase tourism from Canada to Cuba, then take a stronger stand against Justin Trudeau, who is hated by millions of people across the country. This will draw more tourists. Of course, tongue-in-cheek, but, I think this is an important case. And there's another issue that I touched on in the actual articles, is the question of Pierre Trudeau, his role, his legacy in Cuba compared to his son. Now, because of that, this has sort of spilled into a sort of uncritical attitude of Trudeau. But I think this is actually wrong, because as I wrote, if Fidel was alive today, 2020, based on my study of Fidel, which I think is quite extensive, even according to my Cuban colleague, he would have something to say against Justin Trudeau interfering in the internal affairs of Venezuela on behalf of Trump. I'll give you from past experience. I don't know if you recall, there's the 2000 Summit of Americas in Quebec City, and Chrétien, the then Prime Minister of Canada, participated in that summit, and he severely criticized the Cuban government. Now, Chrétien is part of the Trudeau Liberal government, and Fidel Castro did not hesitate for one second. He openly criticized Chrétien and was using various media in Cuba for his position against Cuba, and he even invited me to come to Havana on May 1st, 2001, to give a speech on behalf of the Canadian people against Chrétien's critical analysis of Cuba. So I think that, like, why does the Cuban press not have a less dogmatic view on the issue of the Trudeaus and look at the reality and open up the pages of the other newspapers, such as Granma and Juventud Rebelde, which has the vast majority of readers compared to Trabajadores, to inform the Cuban people what at least Canadians have to say about the current situation in Canada with regards to Latin America and with regards to Cuba. When I give conferences on Cuba, my best drawing card is that Justin Trudeau, after all these attacks by Trump against Cuba since 2016 and in the course of the COVID-19 criminal sanctions increase, how come Trudeau, you have not spoken out once against Trump's policy towards Cuba? So, you know, people, and this is an inspiration to many people within Canada, because we're left, you know, how come Trudeau's not speaking out in defense of our friend Cuba? So I think that these are the things that perhaps would be of interest to the Cuban population and to the readers of Juventud Rebelde and Granma and Cuba Debate, as well as Trabajadores.
Thank you, Arnold. Any other questions, any other comments? Please, those of you who need to go and get tea or coffee, biscuits, whatever it is, go ahead and do that. Any other comments? And then we'll probably just take a 10-minute break and make sure that everybody who was invited has been able to join us.
I have just a brief question for Arnold. Arnold, thank you very much for your presentation. I'm just wondering very quickly, does Canada participate in democracy promotion or regime change activities in Cuba? I'm interested also in Venezuela, but I know we're short on time.
Yeah, Venezuela, of course, is well known. It's obvious through the Lima Group. In Cuba, it's less well known, but Canada traditionally has had this position since 1959. Yes, we recognize the Cuban government. We are refusing to break relations with the Cuban government because we think we could influence things better in Cuba by maintaining relationship with the Cuban government. And in fact, the last time that when Justin Trudeau visited Havana in November 2016, of course, he met with Raul Castro. That was excellent. But he also met, and it's not very well known, he also met with a small group of Cuban dissidents in Havana. As part of this, well, I think you're getting at this notion, we have to try to improve things within Cuba. And then, of course, right after that, it's significant in terms of the evil geopolitics. After his Havana visit, where did he go? He went to Lima, Peru, where along with Peru, they established the Lima Group, which is the vanguard on behalf of Trump for intervention policy against Venezuela.
Excellent. Thank you, Arnold. Thank you, Tisha, Mervyn, Patricia. Thank you, Ruby. Thanks for all your questions. And thanks for a really interesting panel. So let's take a break and we'll be back at 4 o'clock for our next panel, which is Development Challenges for Cuba, Desafíos del Desarrollo para Cuba. Before we go, a greeting from Rodrigo Espina, who's managed to send his audio recording for tomorrow. So all is going well. Although, get yourselves tea and coffee. See you in a little while.